Good morning. Today I'm going to talk about the important difference between understanding and memorizing in physics.
Hey guys.
Hey Bob.
Hi Bob.
Flippin' Physics.
I taught high school physics for 13 years, and every year there was a subset of my students that excelled in math, however struggled in physics, even in my calculus-based AP physics class. It turns out that these students had perfected the art of memorization, more specifically, pattern recognition. They would recognize patterns in the way specific sets of problems were solved, and when they thought they found a problem that looked similar, they would solve it using that same pattern. And this worked well in their math classes, however, it does not work well in physics.
Mr. P?
Yes, Billy?
Do you have any suggestions as to what we should do instead?
Sure, let me give you a specific example. We did three relative motion problems that all started with the exact same vector addition equation. The velocity of the car with respect to the Earth equals the velocity of the car with respect to the paper, plus the velocity of the paper with respect to the Earth. Because they all start the same way, pattern recognition would tell you that you need to solve these three problems the same way. However, when you understand the physics, you will see that while similar, all three problems require a slightly different approach. For the first problem, we used the Pythagorean theorem and SOHCAHTOA. The second problem added a vector that was not in a cardinal direction and therefore needed to be broken into its components before we could solve it in the same way as the first problem. And for the third problem, while the vector addition equation was the same, the vector, which was the hypotenuse of the triangle for the first two problems, was one of the sides of the triangle instead, which meant we had to rearrange the equation before we could work with it.
Wait a minute. That sounds like the problems we did for projectile motion. The first problem we didn't need to break anything into components. For the second problem, we broke the initial velocity into components, and then for the third problem, the known variables were rearranged and the way we solved the problem was just more complicated.
Very good observation, Bo. The way I teach is to introduce a topic at its most basic level, and then to work through progressively more difficult problems having to do with that topic. And with each subsequent problem, you understand the topic just a little bit more and are then able to understand the next problem.
That makes sense. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks.
So my suggestion is that you look at problems and draw connections between them as to why they are solved in a particular way. As Bo just pointed out, when a vector is neither directly in the x or y direction, typically we will break or resolve that vector into its components. We've done this so far in vector addition, projectile motion, and relative motion. And you're actually going to continue to do this for the rest of your physics careers. But the key is to understand why. So, Bobby, please explain to me why we break vectors into components in vector addition.
In vector addition, we use components to make a right triangle so we can use the Pythagorean theorem and SOHCAHTOA. Actually, in relative motion, we also use components to make a right triangle.
And Bo, why do we use components in projectile motion?
We resolve the initial velocity into components because we use different equations in the x and y directions for projectile motion.
Right. We use the equation for constant velocity in the x direction. And in the y direction, we use the equations for free fall.
And when we get to forces, we'll break force vectors into components in the x and y directions. Unless it's on an incline, in which case you break the forces into components in the parallel and perpendicular direction, because perpendicular to the incline, the acceleration is usually equal to zero. And then in circular motion, you're going to break the forces into components in the tangential direction and the in direction, because the centripetal acceleration is always in towards the center of the circle. And but my personal favorite is when you have circular motion on an incline. What happens then is you have to sum the forces.
Oh,
in the,
this would be you lost.
Nah.
I'm sorry. I get pretty excited when I talk about physics.
We know.
Okay, so when you understand why you need to resolve vectors into components, then you will understand when you will need to and in what directions you need to resolve vectors. That is just one example of understanding why rather than memorization or pattern recognition in physics. So please understand why you solve problems, not just how. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.